Hello everyone, I am Dr. Renee Mera, and I'd like to welcome all our TV Asia viewers for this show, as well as our followers on social media. And we're going to be continuing talking about COVID-19 and how this pandemic has so much been part of our life, has consumed our lives completely, and even changing our perception as to how we live our lives. And so continuing the discussion on COVID-19 and what precautions we should take and how we can allay our anxiety and our tension and keep our mental health strong. We have a lot of doctors today on our show. Let's start with Dr. Umlesh Arya. She is the board certified pediatrician, and she is the president of the Association of Indians in America National Chapter. And joining her is Dr. Yashpal Arya. He is a board certified gastroenterologist. And we also have Dr. Ravinder Goyal, and he's a board-certified pulmonary specialist. And joining us is also Dr. Deepak Nandi. He's a board-certified psychiatrist. So gentlemen and ladies, Dr. Arya, welcome to the show. And let's start with Dr. Umlesh Arya. Give us an overview. Do you feel that in New York now, we have hit the apex and I think the worst is over? What is your take on it?
Thank you very much, Renee. First, we have to understand what this virus is. This COVID-19, which we hear a lot about it, it is a single-stranded RNA virus, which is covered with a thin layer of fat that can be melted with the heat and with the soap. And that's why we call it, it is a heat sensitive and can be removed with the soap. So the most important thing to prevent this, get prevention for this virus is, as you hear on TV all the time, the social distance, 6 feet or more, and covering of the face with the mouth and nose with a mask or with the handkerchief is the most important. And if everyone uses this, then social distance, then the curve should start coming down. There was a scientific research published in the New England Journal of Medicine that this virus remain alive for 4 hours in the aerosol. Aerosol is nothing but the fine droplets in the air. It remains alive for 24 hours on the cardboard and remains alive for 2 to 3 days on the surface of the plastic and on the metals. So it is so important for the people to understand that whenever you buy your groceries, you must clean the containers with either Lysol wipes or with the soap and water or with a 1/3 cup of bleach mixed with a gallon of water and clean it out. Then you clean the metals also in the house, your doorknobs to clean the virus. And if you are coming out, your shoes should be out in the garage if you have house, or put it in the closet near the outgoing door so that you don't bring the virus from outside inside the house.
So essentially everything should be sanitized and everything because it's aerosolized. I also heard it's in one of the journals of medicine that there are 3 strains of this virus, and what it does is it gets muted, there's another mutation, and there's a 3 strains, so one could be more deadly than the other. So what came originally is now being mutated. So there's, what's your take because of these strains that can continue for a longer time?
It is very difficult to say. They are trying to make the vaccine, and it is also the same thing that because the they are changing these strands, that's why it is difficult for them to get the vaccine done, but some solution will come, like in the flu vaccine when it started, the flu A, influenza A, influenza B, and then they made the vaccine for both. Right. So they are studying now and doing the work. Let me tell you a few more points how you can prevent to get this COVID virus is by good nutrition and the physical exercise. And the good nutrition will include your high protein diet. Like for vegetarians, you use the milk, yogurt, cheese. If you are beans, dal, which has high in protein. Also, if you are eating egg, then take one egg a day. Must take vitamin C, like in the oranges, or lime, few drops of lime in a lukewarm water, and take 3 to 5 glasses a day is very good. Then the physical exercise increases your immunity, and you can do physical, if you have steps, go up and down on the steps is the best exercise. Otherwise, you can watch ITV, the exercises on the YouTube, follow them and do it in your house.
Okay.
One more thing, the breathing exercise is very important. You take that deep breath in, hold it 3 to 5 seconds, and then breathe out. Do it 5 minutes a day. That will make your lungs strong and keep them well aerated. So these are the points to make you strong and prevent. And I believe in prevention. As a pediatrician, we stress more on the prevention side. If you have the symptoms, then you have to consult like fever, then you have to consult your primary physician. Also, I want to stress upon one more point that go on our website, which is the AIANational.org/COVID-19/. They also have team of doctors. So any COVID related issues, you can consult them.
Thank you, Dr. Yara. It's so important to boost our immunity, and through breathing exercises, eating good diet, you know, and having good physical activity, all this really adds on. And of course, gargling with hot water and turmeric if you can. I'm going to go to Dr. Ravinder Goyal. You are a pulmonary specialist, Dr. Goyal. And this COVID-19 impacts the lungs big time, and that's where the pneumonia comes in. So before it affects the lungs, we got to keep our lungs strong. We talked about breathing and physical activity. From your perspective, from your medical perspective, tell us what we can do so that we can keep our lungs strong, because this really has a very strong negative impact on our lungs.
Most of the coronavirus symptoms, they are like mild to moderate. You may have a cough, fever, and some body ache, headache, and sometime you may have some GI symptoms. So most of the symptoms are mild to moderate, and they do resolve without any treatment, except you can take over-the-counter medication. But once you develop like trouble breathing, chest congestion, or you start seeing change in the mental status, or you start becoming blue, it means this is the time you have to call doctor or call 911 or go to the hospital, because this is the time you are developing respiratory symptoms. When they are mild to moderate symptoms, over-the-counter medications, you know, they will be helpful. And what needs to be done is isolate yourself, and like social isolation, as well as isolate for at least 2 weeks if you're suspecting you may have a coronavirus. But once you develop symptoms, especially, you know, the symptoms I told you, shortness of breath, chest tightness, or change in mental status, you got to go to the hospital. This is also very important for elderly people who are, you know, 65 plus, or they have underlying cardiac disease, lung disease, diabetes, or they are immunosuppressed. Those are the patients they have to go to the hospital, because it's very important for early intervention. As mentioned before, there is no cure for coronavirus as such. When you reach the hospital, you will be diagnosed that what the respiratory symptoms could be either bronchitis or pneumonia. Pneumonia still could be like early stage of pneumonia when you may be treated. Again, I will discuss a little bit more about therapy, but most important that oxygen, if your oxygen level is low, we can give you oxygen by nasal cannula and raise the oxygen saturation more than 95%. But if your oxygen level goes down, then may need more oxygen. And then there may be a stage when may come and may turn into that you may need intubation and mechanical ventilation. That's a very serious complication of coronavirus. So it's beyond not only pneumonia, but now you develop what condition is called ARDS, or adult respiratory distress syndrome. Once you develop ARDS and you are intubated, the prognosis is very poor because as such already discussed that there is no, as such there is no antibiotic like we have for bacterial pneumonia. We have some other drugs, which I will discuss again, but most of the time it's a supportive care. So once somebody is intubated, then they may develop also what's condition is called sepsis, where there is a other organ failure develops. They go in hypotension, renal failure, and also they may, you know, that's the time the patients who are on ventilator, there is very high degree of mortality. In addition to that, not only coronavirus, once they're intubated, they may develop super-added infection, like they may develop bacterial infection also. As far as the treatment of pneumonia is concerned, we have a lot of talk going on, the TV media you're looking at, hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine, which is actually basically anti-malarial drug. Whether this actually
has... But that's not FDA approved. It's not FDA approved right now.
It's not FDA or CDC approved, but it's like a drug which has shown some improvement in the laboratory on the dish, but not in the human beings. We don't have comparative study yet. So as far as that is concerned, the CDC has not recommended that this should be used. But being it's a cheap drug, has been in the market for a long time, has very few side effects. Sometime it develop a cardiac toxicity, like if somebody has a... So we do EKG before that, make sure their QT interval is okay. But most of the time, the drug is being used in the hospital. But we have no, you're right, there is no comparative study or any double-blind study which shows that the chloroquine or hydroxychloroquine is a drug which benefit. Other drug which is there is, a, since it's a viral infection, is a remdesivir, which is given also, was given initially in Ebola in 2009. And that drug also is still experimental. It has been used in some hospital in Chicago and the studies are still going on. And we don't know yet, but that drug is also used. Another medication which can be used when somebody develops pneumonia or far advanced is a what we call this coronavirus produces a lot of cytokines, which are very toxic. And they are the ones which are damaging the lungs and other tissues, cardiac tissues and all that. So anti-cytokinic drugs are being used and which are interleukin-6 drugs. Some of the drugs are being used for that. Again, we don't have studies, but we are using that. And nowadays, they started studying the plasma treatment. What is the plasma? Actually, plasma is somebody who has a coronavirus infection. After 2 weeks or so, they develop antibodies. They develop, start developing antibodies. So that's why 4 to 5 days, they start developing antibodies. Antibody is not a test for infection. It does not tell you there is an infection going on. But once they develop the antibodies and then they're okay for 2 weeks, their serum is collected. And that was given in few of the patients. And that has shown some improvement in terms of, because the antibodies were there against the virus. So this is still a lot of research is going on. A lot of hospitals are trying that, especially when there is no treatment left. So essentially what we are doing is there is a steroid also, but there is no role of steroid in the lungs as far as this is concerned. So eventually what it boils down is a prevention right now. And once the patient goes to the hospital, what we are doing is we are providing them supportive care. If they are hypoxic, we're giving them oxygen. And some of the drugs, which I already discussed, they are the drugs being used.
Thank you, Dr. Goel. That's very insightful advice that you're giving. We know that you know, it's still an unfamiliar territory from the medical perspective. So until the vaccine comes out, until many drugs are, they have clinical trials and they are FDA and CDC approved, we still have to, you know, it's the higher power, I feel, at this time. You know, that's all we can say. Moving on to Dr. Yashpal Arya. Dr. Arya, tell us, you know, there are also gastrointestinal symptoms that a person may have. And tell us, you know, as Dr. Goel said, early detection, early intervention is so very important. So how do we figure out if it's just like acute diarrhea? Is it something more than that? How do we do this kind of a decision on this?
Well, like any other virus which infects respiratory and GI systems, this virus too, mainly the virus first lands up through any source, whether air, it goes through your nose and it sits in the what you call the structures called sinuses. So the first attack of this virus occurs in the pharynx, that is the upper part, back part of your throat, and in the nose, and it grows over there. And it finds low temperature because of the sinuses. So that's where the virus keeps on multiplying. If you attack it at that time, probably won't let the virus go deep in your lungs and deep down in your throat. And that's why, as far as while as Dr. Goel explained, most of the symptoms are respiratory, but we have seen that almost 2 to 25% patients or even more might have GI symptoms. Like you might have heard in the reports also, the very early symptoms, even before the respiratory symptoms start, people have been complaining of loss of taste and loss of smell. It's again because the virus is growing in your mouth and in your nasal area. In GI, a lot of patients, they started developing vague dyspepsia, loss of appetite, and the diarrhea is the most common symptoms. Now, it is very important that once this virus, once it goes to the lungs and it also goes to your stomach and intestines. And we are knowing now that our routine test, which you do nasal swab and pharyngeal swab, it has been noted this virus stays much longer in your GI symptoms. So even they are doing rectal swabs. Now, one of the most important point I would like to make that those people who are staying home, they should remain confined to one room and make sure they have a separate toilet because this virus is richly inhabited in their stools. And make sure they are taught to wash their hands very well. They use their brush, their sink. It should be totally separate because any kind of fecal-oral or fecal contamination can spread it to the other members in the family. So from GI point of view, I would like to stress this point and that the as we said before, even doing some gargles will probably kill the virus right in the throat. But GI symptoms are common. And as far as the treatment is concerned, Dr. Goel has fairly discussed what treatments we have available. But as you know, it's a new territory and we are still trying to find out what is the best way to.
But then when we talk about GI symptoms, it could be also a case of food poisoning. So it's very hard to figure out unless you have a scratchy throat and there are other symptoms that are combining with the GI symptoms.
Yes. Yes, that's right. But usually food poisoning have a lot of vomiting. This virus does not have too much vomiting and abdominal pain, but it may have any diffuse non-specific GI symptoms that part of that.
Thank you so much. And Dr. Nandi, you being a board certified psychiatrist, there's so much going on as we talked about. This is an unfamiliar terrain. It's a new territory from the medical angle. Everything is different. You know, this COVID-19 is changing a lot of people's thinking in many, many ways. And the mental anxiety, the the tension, the stress, the strain that is going along with this, you know, so the closures and everything is different. I mean, you know, nobody thought 2 months ago that we're going to have this kind of pretty much everything closed out. We're not having a lockdown, but, you know, we're sitting in our homes in isolation, social distancing. We never thought. So we're living in very historic times, I would say. And because it's something new from every angle, it creates the stress and the strain and the anxiety. So as a psychiatrist, how do we, because we see the news every day, we watch and hear, and it's depressing, it's devastating when you hear some friend or family member or somebody we know had the virus or is not, you know, working very well with it. What do we do to allay our concerns?
So Dr. Rana Mehra, I will talk to you from my actual experience in the last 1 month. I have been getting more than 2 to 3 consults, new consults, telemedicine consults, directly related to coronavirus for the last 30 days from different Indian groups, from the association, and from the consulate's office. So what I have been noticing is the following things. Based on this actual experience, I can talk about academics, what I've learned from the books or magazines, and I can tell you what I'm actually seeing. Actually, I'm seeing that we are seeing new first onset of psychosis. That is, people who never had psychosis before are having first onset on a lot of young guys who are in this country with minimal social support, and that they got laid off from work, they got furloughed at work, they have rent to pay, and they have worry about immigration, employment, no social support, no money, and just they don't know what is the next thing they are going to do, and no way to go back to India. I'm getting calls from their parents from India, how to manage their case. This is what I've been doing continuously for the last 30 days. We are also seeing a lot of patients with severe anxiety. So people who were mildly anxious are now calling us for anxiolytic medications. Lots of drug addiction. People are staying at home who used to smoke marijuana once a weekend. Now they are smoking on a daily basis. And they're getting fully psychotic because of this, smoking marijuana with their friends, now that they are homebound and not knowing what to do. The third thing I'm seeing is depression. People are depressed and are feeling hopeless and helpless, where this is happening mostly with people who had restaurant business. They had small Subways, pizza stores, and I'm getting these calls that what will happen, how will they ever come back to work, and how they're going to take care of all their debt responsibilities and getting extremely suicidal on that. People are calling up on the weekends and are begging for drugs, which are extremely habit forming. And we have to now talk to them about the side effect of those medications. So one thing I will say, that the best thing to do is not to have information overload. For the layman, having a lot of information overload and having a lot of confused messaging is now creating a lot of processing disability, and they are not able to process and make head and tail of what they need to do. And there is a lot of social media group with all kind of calamities being promoted in the social media group. One social media group even talked about how the virus can spread through their Zoom, and people are they're talking about all this nonsense. So the most important mental health issues are, number one, minimize the information overload. Number two, stick to your routine. That is, you get up at the same time, do your exercise, take your shower, have your breakfast, do your work exactly the same way as if you are going to the office and sitting in front of your computer or desktop and planning out what kind of work you can do. without having information overload. Number four, to practice meditation and all kind of behavioral techniques without going to marijuana and drugs, because what is happening is this overt drug usage is leading to more depression, more anxiety, to a level of functioning that they are getting psychotic, especially between the age group of 20 to 40. We are seeing a lot of young, isolated Indians who live in Greater New York metropolitan area with minimal social support, and they just are going through almost like a group psychosis. 2-3 friends together, all smoking pot, and all getting overwhelmed. I have also started treating a lot of suicidal patients, and it is extremely important now because the hospitals are not allowing the patients to come into the hospital. The urgent care centers are not allowing the patients who are suicidal to come to their place because they don't know their coronavirus status, that they need to get into the line and get online support, get help on telemedicine, doing telepsychiatry, get all kind of support, because this is the most important thing one needs to do. And with that, I will say that this is my actual experience in the last 30 days.
Dr. Nandi, also, we talked about people are feeling very vulnerable. There's a feeling of lack of control in our lives. But importantly, there are people who are victims of domestic violence as well, right, with their home. And that's creating more issues and concerns. So how would you address that as a psychiatrist?
Yes. Fortunately, I have not yet seen in the last 30 days any patient who were getting abused. Yes, I have read in the literature and in my psychiatric journals, because people are living in close quarters and are not able to avoid themselves, they are now more susceptible to domestic abuse. I have not seen a patient in the last 30 days. It is very important that anybody who gets hit, they need to immediately call police and get family support. Because once it starts, it is only going to get worse. From one slap, it is going to be two slap, to third, it will be soon serious abuse, which can almost lead to murder or severe violence. And so I will counsel everybody, the whole audience, anytime anybody starts abusing you physically, you definitely need to call your police or 911 and absolutely bring your support system that way. Even one hit is too much, because it will only exaggerate to the max. And that's all I can say about that.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Nandi. And most importantly, like other doctors have mentioned, that it is important to keep your daily routine. It is important to maintain what you've been doing, getting up at the right time in the morning, doing the breathing exercises, walk inside your home, just put yourself on a timer and walk around. Stay positive. That's the most important thing. Stay calm, stay positive, and meditation. That'll connect you to your inner core and, make you feel much better, because the information on COVID-19 is evolving every day. So that's where these messages come in, like today was this, tomorrow might be something different. So best is to stay home, stay calm, stay positive, meditate, do your daily chores, your daily routine inside your home, make the best cooking recipes right at this time. And, social distancing is there, but you can still make video calls to your family and friends and see how they're doing and feel just good, and keep your immunity strong. So I want to thank Dr. Umesh Arya, a board-certified pediatrician and president of Association of Indians in America, the national chapter, Dr. Yashpal Arya, who's a board-certified gastroenterologist, Dr. Ravinder Goyal, who's a board-certified pulmonary specialist, and Dr. Deepak Nandi, board-certified psychiatrist. And again, please stay calm, stay positive, stay healthy. I'm Dr. Renee Mera. Thank you so much for watching.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.